Okay, so in the last class, we started looking at the non-idealities that a transistor presents. We are going to continue looking at some more of those. So last time, the one specific non-ideality that we looked at was the problem of velocity saturation, right? So what we saw was, under normal circumstances, we are making the assumption that the velocity of the carriers, right, the electrons in the case of a NMOS transistor or holes in the case of a PMOS transistor, is expected to be linear with the magnitude of the electric field that is applied. Right? But in practice, what happens is, as the electric field gets larger and larger, effectively what ends up happening is, after a point you reach a stage where the electrons are facing so much of collisions with the other neighboring atoms that are present in the substrate that they are no longer able to accelerate beyond a certain velocity. Right? Typically that velocity is in the range of around 10 to the 5 meters per second or thereabouts. Okay? Speed of light is 10 to the power of 8 meters per second. The electrons are around 10 to the 5 meters per second, but this is inside a solid substrate and they are real physical particles with mass. Okay? So you can see that the speed is quite high. 10 to the power of 5 meters per second is not a very low speed. And beyond that, it ends up saturating. It is not able to accelerate any further simply because of the physical properties of the material. Okay? So what ends up happening is that the velocity sort of flattens out. We approximate it by saying that there is some critical field such that mu times EC is the maximum velocity that can be attained by the electrons under the influence of a field. So any field greater than EC, the field may exist. I mean, it's possible to have a field which is greater than that magnitude, right? But the velocity of the electrons will not go mu multiplied by that field. Okay? So that, what happens as a result of that, effectively what we are saying is that normally when does this sort of the lateral field, the drain to source field, when does it come into existence? When there is a VDS, drain to source voltage, right? So as the drain to source voltage increases, what we are saying is at some point we will hit this critical voltage, or the critical voltage, which in turn is related to the critical field that can be sustained in the substrate. Okay? And once you reach that value, then any further increase in the voltage, which results in an increase in the field, will not result in an increase in velocity of the electrons, and therefore will not result in an increase in current. Okay? So instead of going all the way up to VDS equal to VGS minus VT, where the pinch off occurs and current stops increasing, when VDS becomes equal to this VD sat itself, the current stops increasing. Okay. So anyway, that's velocity saturation. Once again, we are also given you that, you know, the SPICE assignment that you will be doing will be related to actually plotting some of these curves, right? The ID versus VGS, VDS and so on, characteristics of a transistor, and matching that against these equations. What you will find when you run those experiments is that these equations versus what you get from the actual simulations differ quite a lot. Right? So why is that? I mean, why are we deriving all of these equations when we know that the final result is quite different from it? Because the final result is actually a much more complex equation. It is a much more accurate representation of what is happening inside the transistor. Right? It is a much better physical model of what is actually going on inside the transistor, and therefore more accurate for real calculations, but too complicated for hand calculations, so we don't bother with it when we are just trying to form estimates of currents. Okay. But knowing these equations, knowing these properties, what is it that's actually happening, is very important for all of us as designers, because we need to know in broad terms how much can the current increase, when will it stop increasing, what are the other effects that will come into the picture, what are the things I need to be concerned about, and so on. Okay. As far as actual values are concerned, you don't bother and you just say, okay, I'll use the simulations, they are more accurate. Alright, so velocity saturation is one of the non-idealities. The next thing that we can see is, once again looking at the channel model, right? So what we saw was some kind of a channel forms over here, but if you look at it, there are these two depletion regions that come into existence to start with, right? And the application of this VDS will also, among other things, cause this depletion region to increase in size. Okay? So as a result of this and some other properties of how the transistor works, one of the effects that comes about over here is that as VDS increases, the effective length of the channel decreases, right? So this is the effective length of the channel, right? By the way, there is also one other term which so far I have not really looked at. There are, when we talk about the length of a channel, there are two things that we need to be concerned about. Okay? One is what is called the drawn length, or LD. Right? So the drawn length is simply saying, okay, this is how wide I have made it according to whatever structures I am putting down on silicon. Okay, so this is just where I have drawn my markers and where I have created my masks. Okay, but the actual L, which comes into the picture when we are trying to estimate the amount of current and all the electric field and so on, is a slightly different value, because the regions that are being doped, the N plus regions, are not sort of abruptly starting at one point. There are no like clear cut definitions over there. They tend, the N plus regions sort of tend to go slightly under the regions that you have drawn, so under the gate, right? Because of all of that, there is something called the L effective. Right? So this LD versus L effective is once again something which is sort of a empirical fitting term that we use, right? We know that there is a discrepancy. There are some kinds of models which tell us, okay, for this drawn length under these conditions, this is the actual effective length. So the SPICE models also make adjustments for that, where they are calculating the length of a transistor. Okay, there's nothing much that you can do about it. As far as we are concerned, only L drawn is in our control, right? But it's good to be aware of this, because it does impact the results that you get. Okay, now anyway, so that's a sort of slight side topic. As far as we are concerned, now the important thing over here is the effective length of the channel, because of this effect of VD increasing, will change. In particular, that length will slightly decrease. Okay? So what we have over here is, as VDS increases, the effective length of the channel decreases. What will happen to the current as a result of that? What will happen to the current when the effective length of a channel decreases? The current should increase, right? So this is a relatively small effect. It's not that there's a huge increase in the current as a result of this, but it is a noticeable increase. Okay? What ends up happening is, if you were to plot ID versus VDS for some fixed value of VGS, right, what we would expect to see is initially there is an increase followed by a flattening out. Okay, where does that flattening out? Is it at VGS minus VT or is it at VD sat? That depends on whether the transistor's velocity saturated or not, and so on. Okay, right now we don't care about that. The important part that we are concerned about is the flattening. Okay, now what we are saying is, as VDS increases, the effective length is decreasing, right? And as a result of that, right, there is a certain increase in the current that flows. Now, this is not a very straightforward statement. I already made some things, made some statements saying that, you know, after a point the electric field saturates, so there is no further increase in current, that is why it's flattening and so on. Now I'm saying because the L decreased, the current will increase, right? So this is at best a sort of crude way of understanding what is actually happening over there, right? If you try sort of reconciling this with velocity saturation, you will probably get confused. I already said the thing is velocity saturated, there can be no further increase in, after all the electric field has saturated, how can there still be an increase in current? The effects are slightly different over here. Okay? I'm not going to go into the physics of it or try to understand why these things actually occur. This is an observed phenomenon and it is explained partly because of the fact that the L effective is decreasing. If you don't want to bother about the fact that the L effective decreases, then you can actually leave that out. Anyway, the way that we model it is to say that there is some dependence on VDS. Okay? So what happens in practice is that the current ends up going something like this. Okay? There is some rate of increase which at least to first order can be approximated as a constant rate of increase. Okay, it looks pretty much, if you actually look at the current curves that are measured, right, it turns out that it looks pretty much like a straight line with a fixed slope. Straight line means fixed slope, of course, right? So what we do, rather than sort of trying to account for reduced lengths and then having to worry about whether there is saturation, this, that and the other, we just say, okay, look, we need to fit this model over here. We will use one empirical term and say that as the VDS increases, the current is going to increase beyond a point. Okay? So the ID in this region is going to be the ID0, right? I'm going to call this as ID0. Multiplied by 1 plus lambda VDS. Okay, to be more specific, lambda n, because this is a lambda parameter that refers specifically to the electron carriers that are present over here. Okay, so like I said, this is an equation that we are concerned with. We don't care about why exactly it behaves in this way. We only care about the fact that it does behave this way and that this is a reasonably good approximation to the actual current that you obtain. Okay. So now this effect is called channel length modulation. For obvious reasons, right? As I said, the increase in VDS is causing a change or modulating the channel length, right? And that in turn has a secondary effect on the current itself that flows through the transistor. Okay? And this lambda is called the channel length modulation parameter. Okay? Now keep in mind, there is one thing. Normally when we are talking about VLSI design, there is another lambda parameter that comes into the picture, right? The lambda that I was talking about with regard to the minimum feature size. Okay, so when we say 180 nanometers, for example, there is a lambda associated with that which says that that 180 nanometers can be considered as some 2 lambda. Okay, so what is this 2 lambda? So I'm slightly digressing here, but I just want to clarify this point. So when I say 180 nanometers, I I have a parameter called lambda, and I say that 180 nanometers is equal to 2 lambda, which means basically that lambda is equal to 90 nanometers, right? And all my measurements from here onwards, right, in terms of how big the transistor is, how wide a wire is, what is the spacing between wires, all of that is expressed in terms of lambda. Okay. Now, why did I not just straight away say that, you know, 180 nanometers itself is lambda and express everything in terms of lambda? That's because there might be situations where I want to talk about something which is 3 lambda, which is 1.5 times the minimum size. Okay. But we don't ever go for something like 1.1 times the feature size or 1.25 times the feature size. 1.5. That's about all that. That was a choice that was made somewhere early on in the days of VLSI design. Okay. So this lambda is sort of, it's called the scalable CMOS parameter. Right? And all kinds of design rules are built around this parameter. Right? The most basic design rule is the spacing between the drain and source of a transistor cannot be, has to be a multiple of lambda, but cannot be less than 2 lambda. In general, for digital circuits, it is going to be 2 lambda. For analog, you might have transistors whose length is not 2 lambda. Okay? What about the width? Once again, it has to be a multiple of lambda. For the minimum size transistor, in the case of 180 nanometers, we say that it is 4 lambda. In 250 nanometers, we would consider it as 3 lambda. Right? It depends on the process. There might be a 180 nanometer process where you allow a transistor of a width of 3 lambda also. But everything is going to be in terms of that lambda. Right? If I draw a wire, which is after all just a piece of metal on the silicon, the thickness of that wire, the width of that wire has to be a multiple of lambda. If there are two wires, the space between them, the separation between them has to be a multiple of lambda. Okay? So this lambda is a very crucial parameter as far as scalable CMOS is concerned. Why is it called scalable CMOS? The whole purpose of introducing this lambda parameter was, they said, okay, look, we are going to a lot of effort to design something, design a gate, let's say a NAND gate or a NOT gate or whatever it is, at some technology. After a couple of years, the process engineers come along and say, okay, look, we can now go to half that size or one over root two of that size. Right? So what do we do? Do we need to go back and design all of those NAND gates, NOT gates, all of those things once again from scratch? Instead, what we'll say is we'll take our existing design and just scale everything by whatever scaling factor they have given us. Okay? So if we design everything in terms of one abstract parameter called lambda, we need to make just one change somewhere in our design. Change that number lambda. And everything changes correspondingly. It's sort of like using a hash defined in a C program, right? You define a constant, use it everywhere else. You have a faster computer, go change that one constant, everything else changes. Okay? So that was the purpose behind the introduction of this lambda, scalable CMOS parameter to start with. Now, eventually, as we go to smaller and smaller technologies, we have gone from 180 down to 130, 90, 65 and so on, right? The usefulness of this lambda parameter has become questionable because it's no longer just something where, you know, you scale that thing and everything works. Various other things also have changed. So now people stop talking about design rules in terms of lambda parameters. They usually say it directly in terms of number of microns. Okay? And rather than trying to remember so many different rules, they allow the computer to keep track of it and see whether the rules are being met or not. Okay? But this lambda parameter, just for the convenience of thinking how well we can sort of understand these circuits in terms of that thing, it has remained historical. Okay. The important point as far as we are concerned now is this lambda has nothing to do with the channel length modulation parameter. One thing, of course, the units are completely different. The lambda n is, what is its unit? 1 by volt, right? Because if you are multiplying by VDS, and it has to become a dimensionless quantity, 1 plus lambda VDS, so it has to become dimensionless. So lambda n itself has to be 1 over volt. Okay? Whereas this lambda, what is its unit? length, nanometers or microns, right? Because you are using it as a scaling factor for lengths. Okay. Alright. So channel length modulation has been observed and can be modeled using this equation. So what we do is, along with the overall equation that we had, right? So normally what happens is the channel length modulation we would consider only after pinch off or something like that, right? So some amount of saturation has occurred, pinch off has happened, then we find that the channel length is being modulated by this application of this excess voltage, etc., etc. So we use this thing. Instead, what we say is, let's not worry about that, let's bring it directly into that original combined equation that we had, right? So we have an equation saying where this V min was equal to the minimum amount VGS minus VT, VDS and VD sat. What we say is, we'll just introduce this new parameter here, 1 plus lambda n VDS. Okay. So we effectively expand that combined equation to take the channel length modulation parameter also into account. Now if you look closely at this, a number of questions once again pop up. Channel length modulation, we normally talk about it in saturation region, under velocity saturation, what does channel length modulation mean, under linear region, what does channel length modulation mean? We are sort of brushing all of those things aside and saying, look, you want to understand those, look at the more detailed physical models. For now, this is a combined equation which serves our purpose. It combines everything in a nice way that we can use. So we just go ahead and use this equation. Okay. Now, having said all this about channel length modulation, the important point is, for us as digital designers, this is actually a very secondary effect. We don't really worry too much about it, right? The main impact that this has is in the output resistance. You can look at this curve and sort of understand that the output impedance of the transistor is going to be determined by that slope of that curve, the ID versus VDS. Right? Which means that for analog designs, you are really concerned about this parameter. It actually affects what kind of slope you are going to get, therefore what kind of output impedance you can get from a transistor stage. Right? Whereas in digital circuits, we are normally operating at one of the two extremes of the transistor. Either it is cut off or it is fully saturated. Very rarely are we concerned with the transition between those two. Rather, we are concerned with the transition, but only to the extent that how fast can it do that. We are not really concerned about at a particular point what is the small signal behavior of this. There are no small signals in digital circuits. Okay. So, as far as we are concerned, for the most part, we can sort of ignore the effect of channel length modulation. We need to know it exists because it will affect the final currents that can be obtained. But apart from that, we don't need to worry too much about its effect itself. Okay? Alright. So, the next effect or the next non-ideality that we need to concern ourselves with is the so-called body bias effect. Okay? Now what happens in the body bias effect is this. Once again, going back to our drawing of the transistor. The main difference you will notice in this diagram from the previous ones that I have been using so far is the fact that this bulk terminal I am no longer grounding. Okay? So I am trying to understand what happens if I actually change the potential on the bulk terminal. Okay? If it's no longer just set to ground, what could potentially happen over here? Right? So the main thing that happens over here is what happens as a result of applying a potential on the bulk terminal? What is it that you would expect to see? Reverse bias, where? So you have a P type over here, you have Pn plus region, so there, right? If you apply a positive voltage on B, then effectively you are sort of applying a forward bias on those diodes. So clearly there is a problem with this. You don't want to apply a very large forward bias, right? Because at some point, if the forward bias becomes large enough, those two diodes will become conducting, right? Which can have potentially very disastrous effects on the overall transistor, on the system itself, right? So sort of increasing B may not be a great idea, okay? But if you want, you can do it, and you know, by doing so, basically it will have certain effect on various other parameters of the circuit and so on, right? But in general, this is one of the reasons why the bulk terminal is usually connected to the ground, or in general, the most negative potential in the circuit, right? You do not, under any circumstances, want a positive bias, a forward bias, to occur on these PN junctions, okay? So because of that, the bulk terminal is usually kept at a lowest potential in the circuit. But now what we are asking is, beyond that, what happens if I further increase it or further change that? Okay. So intuitively, what will happen if I applied a source to bulk potential greater than zero? That is, I make the bulk more negative. The depletion region increases. That can have an effect on the threshold voltage. Effectively, ultimately what we are going to do is, see, what we are interested in over here is what happens to that potential at the interface, just under that gate surface, right? Under what conditions will it invert and form a channel, okay? Applying a potential, changing the value of the bulk, changes the relative difference between the gate and the bulk terminal, right? And can in turn change the amount of voltage on the gate which is required in order to invert the channel, okay? So once again, what I am going to do over here is, without going into the details of the physics behind it or why it works, we are going to straight away model this entire effect in terms of an equation and a couple of parameters, okay? What we are saying is the effect of any change in the bulk potential can be captured as an effect on, as an effect on the value of the threshold voltage, okay? That is given by this Vt. The new value of Vt is going to be given by the original value of Vt when there is no surface and source to bulk potential, plus this parameter gamma, once again some empirical physical parameter, multiplied by square root of phi s plus Vsb minus square root of phi s. Okay, so we have two parameters over here. There is this gamma and there is this phi s. Okay, why this equation in terms of square root of something and so on? If you look at how it is derived, it makes sense, right? You'll be able to get that, but I'm not going into that derivation. Okay, so as far as we are concerned, what's the important point over here? The main takeaway from this is, it is possible to change my threshold voltage. Okay. How much can I change the threshold voltage? That depends on the parameters. What is the value of gamma? What is the value of phi s and so on? Phi s is a physical parameter purely dependent on the relative materials that are being used, right? The silicon, the metal, the insulator, all of those have an effect on phi s. But that's about it. I mean, it's just a physical property of the material. gamma is also a physical property of the material, but it is more something empirically determined. It's also a function of the doping concentrations and so on. Okay. So in that way, I might have some degree of control over gamma. Phi s I don't really have control over, it is just a property of what material I use. But the important point is VSB is something in my control, even as a circuit designer. Okay. So as a person designing the final circuit, it is possible that I might actually at some point be able to make use of this VSB in order to change the threshold voltage. Okay. How much can I change it, of course, depends on the values of phi s and gamma, right? As some assignments later, we'll take up some sample values and see roughly what are the range of changes that you can make. But it's definitely possible. So for example, with the base threshold voltage VT naught of let's say 0.4 volts, it would definitely be possible to sort of modulate this up to 0.5, 0.6 volts or so, right? Now what happens when you increase the threshold voltage? A number of things happen. Essentially, the current that is going to flow is actually going to decrease, right? Because when you increase the threshold voltage, it inverts later, the amount of current that you get for a given value of VGS and VDS will decrease. Okay. But it also has another side effect which we will see later, which is that the leakage current or the amount of current that is getting, that is just being dissipated as a wasted current, can actually decrease as a result of this. Right. So there might be situations where you actually want to sort of modulate this. And one of the things is essentially this body biasing, right? Changing this VSB is usually called body biasing, or sometimes called bulk bias and so on, or substrate biasing. Right, all of those terms you might come across as you look at the literature. Okay. So there are two situations where this can arise. One is, I consciously go and essentially change the value of VB. Right? I actually use this as a parameter that allows me to get some degree of control over the source to bulk voltage, and I use it in order to change my threshold voltage. Right? But there is another kind of situation where this occurs, where we really don't want it, but it happens anyway. I'll just quickly give an example of where this could happen. We'll understand it a bit better once we start looking at more complex gates, right? Imagine a situation where I have two NMOS transistors which are put together in a so-called stack. Okay. So now this is ground. Right, the lower terminal, whatever terminal that we have here, this is source, this is drain, source of this one, drain of this one. Okay. Now this is connected somewhere, we don't care where. The upper drain is connected to something else, probably to some PMOS transistors, and the output. The gates are connected to some inputs, we don't again care what they are. The important point is this one. The point that I have marked as X, right? It is the drain of one transistor and the source of the other transistor. Okay? Depending on the circuit scenario, how things are set up, it is entirely possible for this X to be at a potential which is not zero. In fact, that will definitely have to happen at some point, right? Because otherwise there is no point in having the lower transistor, because its source and bulk will always, source and drain will always be at the same potential. So obviously there has to be a situation where the drain potential of the lower transistor can increase. That means the source potential of the upper transistor has increased. But the bulk of the upper transistor is still connected to ground. Okay? So this can easily have a situation where VSB, source to bulk potential, is greater than zero. What impact does that have? It raises the threshold voltage of the upper transistor, changes the amount of current that can flow through it, and therefore it can have an impact on the total current flowing through that part of the circuit, which in turn, as we will see later, will impact things like the propagation delay, how quickly the transistor can charge or discharge a circuit that is connected to it. Okay. So this is actually, I mean, so body biasing, in other words, is not just some abstract thing that we use if we want to get some special properties. It actually occurs fairly commonly in normal digital circuits. Most of the time it's not a desirable effect, but in certain circumstances we may be able to make use of it. Okay. As far as we are concerned, what do we need to know about it? That it can be modeled as a change in the threshold voltage given by this equation. Okay. Okay, going further, the next non-ideality that we need to concern ourselves with is, we are now going to look at the so-called cutoff region of operation, right? I'm assuming the source is grounded, drain to start with is grounded, but whatever, we are going to apply some small potential to it and see what happens. VGS is less than VT. Okay, this is the scenario in which we are operating. Now, what do I expect in such a scenario? What we said was there is no channel, so there is no real scope for flow of current between drain and source, right? But in practice, some amount of current can continue to flow, because even though we said that, you know, the formation of a channel can be treated as some sort of an abrupt occurrence, it's an exponential growth, so it's a very rapid formation of the channel over there. Yes, all that is true, but very rapid still means it has some dependence on the gate to source voltage. Okay, so for some changes in gate to source voltage, it will get closer and closer to forming a channel, and then suddenly at some point we say, okay, this is good enough, that is actually inverted. Okay, we are sort of drawing a line and saying, okay, this is inverted, this is not inverted. The reality is more a continuum. Okay, so what ends up happening is that current that we sort of assumed was zero is actually not zero, it's actually going to be something which dies away slowly, not slowly, dies away with reduction in the gate to source voltage. Okay, one way of sort of understanding it is if we were to plot log of ID. Okay, now you can't really take log of a quantity with units, so this is obviously log of ID divided by some reference, maybe by 1 microamp or whatever it is. Okay, but we plot it as a function of VGS. Right? For some value of VDS. Okay? Normally, what would I expect? I would expect to see that until VT, there is no current at all. After VT, how is the function of ID versus VGS minus VT? For a large value of VDS, forget velocity, saturation and so on, it should be a parabola, right? That VGS minus VT the whole square. So, or if there is velocity saturation, it should be linear. It should be something related to VGS minus VT. So, in either case, it will be something which grows like this. Okay? Remember, it's an exponential curve, or rather exponential axis. So in fact what will happen is it will not look like a straight line at all, it will look something more which is flattening out. Okay, because the exponential axis grows much faster than the actual function itself does, right? But when we go to VGS minus VT or go below VT, what actually happens in practice is now we find that the current starts dropping with something that looks linear, but in this exponential chart where the y-axis is exponential. So what does that mean? It basically means that there is an exponential drop in current. For a fixed change in VGS. Okay. So if I change VGS by, let's say, 5 millivolts, maybe I get a 2x reduction in the current. Another 5 millivolts, another 2x. Another 5 millivolts, further 2x. So 2 times for every 5 millivolts. That is what this curve makes. Okay. So it is actually dropping off very quickly, but when I plot it on this exponential scale, it actually looks like a straight line. It makes it, more importantly, makes it clear that the current is not zero. It is small, but definitely not instantaneously going to zero. Okay. Once again, we have a equation that models this. The equation is actually a bit complex, because even though I only talked about the relationship with VGS, it turns out there is also another secondary effect which on VDS, which has an impact on the current. Okay, so the overall current equation is given by this expression. IDS0 is some baseline current multiplied by e to the power of VGS minus VT divided by this term n times what notation to use for this varies from one book to another. Okay, I'm going to use the expression small v capital T. Okay, which basically is the expression Kp by Q. Okay. So this particular term, that thermal voltage, there's one thing which you need to keep in mind. Depending on which textbook you look at, you might find different notations used for it. Okay. It's not a nice situation. It can lead to confusion if you look at different books and, you know, you see Vt being used in one place, you see the same Vt being used for something else in another place. It is probably safer if, instead of this confusion, we just use Kt by Q throughout. Okay. As far as possible in future also, I'll just use the Kt by Q term in order to refer to it. But in case you do come across it, please keep in mind that as far as we are concerned, for the most part, Vt, capital V, subscript capital T, is the threshold voltage. Okay. Small v, subscript capital T, in this case, is a thermal voltage. Okay. So these are terms that we sort of need to keep in mind. Vt is the most common one, the threshold voltage that we are going to be using repeatedly. So at least in most cases, when you see it, you should be able to recognize which one it is. Do not say that I saw this term and therefore I confused it for something else. You should be able to look at the equation and figure out which is the right term, what is meant to be there. Okay. Anyway, so the important point is Vgs minus Vt by N into Kt by Q multiplied by a sort of secondary term, 1 minus e to the minus VDS divided by, once again, this thermal voltage. So let's look at this equation carefully. IDS0 is a constant. E to the power of VGS minus VT divided by N KT by Q, which means that as VGS minus VT increases, there is an exponential increase in this IDS. Okay. But this is true only for the region where VGS minus VT is less than 0. Okay. When VGS is less than VT, this is true. Otherwise, of course, the IDS is given by whatever your linear region or saturation region currents. Why? Because once inversion occurs, this whole model changes. You can no longer use the same equation, right? But until you reach inversion, we can use this expression over here. Okay. So what does it mean? I mean, okay, so that's one part of it. The second part of it is 1 minus e to the power of minus VDS by VT, which means that it also has an impact, and or rather VDS also has an impact on the current. But you look at the term, clearly it is a secondary term. It does not have such a large impact on the current as the first e to the power of VGS minus VT by N KT by Q. Okay. So for the time being, we'll leave that expression aside completely, that part of the expression aside. Let's understand what is the impact of this VGS minus VT dependence. Okay. What we are saying is, supposing I have IDS 1, is this IDS 0 e to the power of VGS 1 minus VT divided by N KT by Q. Okay, I'm leaving out the second term. And I have another IDS 2. It's also given by IDS 0 into e to the power of VGS 2 minus VT divided by N KT by Q. Multiplied by the same term. Okay. Let's consider a situation where IDS 2 by IDS 1 is equal to 10. Okay. First of all, which one? IDS 2 or IDS 1? Which one corresponds to a higher value of VGS? IDS 2, right? So IDS 2 is the higher current. It corresponds to VGS 2. So in other words, the larger value of VGS leads to a larger value of current. Okay. What is this current? It is a current which is flowing from drain to source when the VGS is less than VT. Okay. So this is called a sub-threshold conduction. Right? And if I look at this term, then effectively what I am saying is IDS 2 by IDS 1 is equal to 10 is equal to the IDS zeros cancel out, e to the power of, if I rewrite all the terms, VGS 2 minus VGS 1 divided by N KT by Q. Okay, the VT is also cancelled because e to the power of A divided by e to the power of B is e to the power of A minus B. Okay, so I am sort of collapsing all the terms together. Right? I will take log on both sides. Okay? I am going to take the natural log so that the e power goes away. Or in other words, the delta VGS is given by this term, N KT by Q ln 10. Okay? What delta VGS? This was the delta VGS which caused a factor of 10 change in the current. Okay? One way to think about is, VGS 2 was higher than VGS 1. As I reduced from VGS 2 to VGS 1, I caused a 10x reduction in the current. Okay, so if it was 100 microamps to start with, by the time I have gone down by this amount, it has gone down to 10 microamps. If I go further, another delta VGS, the same delta VGS, it will go down to 1 microamp. Another delta VGS, 100 nanoamps and so on. Okay, it rapidly starts dropping again. So the question is, how big is this quantity, right? Now KT by Q, what's the value approximately? 25, 26 millivolts, somewhere in that range, right? Ln 10, it's around 2.3 or thereabouts, right? So this is approximately equal to N times 60 millivolts, right? Approximately. So now comes the question, what is N? Turns out N is also a physical parameter. In our case, it's empirically derived from the curves that we actually observe, right? The important question is, what would you like N to be? Do you want it to be a large quantity, a small quantity? Small. Why? Because the smaller the value of N, the smaller the delta VGS required for a 10x reduction in current. Okay, so ideally I would like N to be, if it's possible to get it less than 1, then great, but it turns out N is know, the way that it's defined itself, it is something greater than or equal to 1. Okay? So at least I would like it to be as close to 1 as possible. If it is 1, then effectively what it's saying is for a 60 millivolt reduction in voltage below threshold, I get a 10x reduction in current. Okay? So let's say my threshold was 0.4 volts, 400 millivolts. By the time my VGS has come down to 340, my current has come down from 100 microamps to 10. By the time it goes to 280, it's come down to 1 microamp. By the time it goes down to 220, it's gone down to 100 nanoamps. Okay? So I'll get a very rapid reduction in the current as a result of this change in voltage. In practice, it turns out that's too good to happen. N turns out to be greater than 1. Okay? And a typical value is somewhere in the region of 1.5 or so. So 1.5 basically means 90 millivolts, right, required for 10x reduction in current. Okay? So this parameter S is called the subthreshold conduction parameter. Is equal to 90 millivolts per decade. What does that mean? It means 90 millivolts is the delta VGS required for 1 decade change, 1 factor of 10 change in current. Okay? So usually the subthreshold parameter is expressed in terms of millivolts per decade. We would like it to be 60 or even smaller if possible, but a more realistic number is somewhere around 90 or so, at least for the 180 nanometer process that we have. Okay? And this means that every 90 millivolts drop below threshold will result in a 10x reduction in current. Okay. Alright, so we'll stop here for now. There are just a couple of more non-idealities that we need to very quickly look at, and then we'll start looking at the capacitances associated with transistors.